16.10. On one occasion, the Venerable Mahakasapa was dwelling at Savarthi in Jeta's grove, Nathapindika's park. Then in the morning, the Venerable Ananda dressed, and taking bowl and robe, he approached the Venerable Mahakasapa and said, "Come, Venerable Kasapa, let us go to the nun's quarters." And Venerable Mahakasapa said, "You go, friend Ananda. You are the busy one with many duties." Let's stop here for a moment. You see, the Buddha, after he allowed nuns, allowed women to go forth as nuns, he made certain rules. One of the rules was every 2 weeks, they have to be given some instructions by a senior monk. And the senior monk generally in the Vinaya has to be, if possible, one with 20 vasal at least, who has taken the higher ordination 20 years or more. So, Venerable Ananda wanted to go and give teaching instructions to the nuns. Then he invited Venerable Kasapa to accompany him, because monks cannot go to the nuns' quarters alone. They have to be accompanied by another man. So, Venerable Kasapa said, "You go, you are the one with many duties." He doesn't like to do all these. He likes to meditate only, Venerable Mahakasapa. He doesn't like to do this and do that. The second time, the Venerable Ananda said to the Venerable Mahakasapa, "Come, Venerable Kasapa, let us go to the nun's quarters." "You go, friend Ananda. You are the busy one with many duties." The third time, the Venerable Ananda said to the Venerable Mahakasapa, "Come, Venerable Kasapa, let us go to the nun's quarters." Then in the morning, the Venerable Mahakasapa dressed and taking bowl and robe, went to the nun's quarters with the Venerable Ananda as his companion. So, stop here for a moment. You see, so here, Venerable Kasapa, even though he didn't want to go, but because Venerable Ananda asked him 3 times, then only he complied. When he arrived, he sat down on the appointed seat. Then a number of nuns approached the Venerable Mahakasapa, paid homage to him, and sat down to one side. As they were sitting there, the Venerable Mahakasapa instructed, exhorted, inspired, and gladdened those nuns with a Dharma talk, after which he rose from his seat and departed. Then the nun, Tulatisa, being displeased, expressed her displeasure thus, How can Master Mahakasapa think of speaking the Dhamma in the presence of Master Ananda, the Videhan sage? For Master Kasapa to think of speaking on the Dhamma in the presence of Master Ananda, the Videhan sage, this is just as if a needle peddler would think he could sell a needle to a needle maker. Stop here for a moment. So this nun, Tulatisa, she was a fan of this Venerable Ananda. He thought highly of Venerable Ananda, but didn't like Venerable Mahakasapa. Later you see why. Because Venerable Mahakasapa is one of those monks who are very blunt. Doesn't speak ing siu wa, doesn't speak sweet words. Very to the point, sometimes so much to, it sometimes hurts people. It's very blunt. So, Venerable Ananda is different. Venerable Ananda is very popular with a lot of women. He's like a very gentleman type. So, this nun says, "Master Ananda is supposed to be the most knowledgeable on the Dhamma, because Venerable Ananda is a personal attendant of the Buddha. So, wherever the Buddha goes, Venerable Ananda is the one who is with the Buddha most of the time." The second half of the Buddha's ministry. So he has heard most of the suttas more than other monks. So because of that, this nun thought, this Venerable Ananda, this should be the Dhamma preacher, not Venerable Kasapa. So she passed a nasty remark. He said, just like a needle peddler, a person selling needle, things want to sell the needle to the needle factory. The Venerable Mahakasapa overheard the nun, Tulatisa, making this statement, and he said to the Venerable Ananda, "How is it, friend Ananda? Am I the needle peddler and you the needle maker, or am I the needle maker and you the needle peddler?" And then Venerable Ananda was very embarrassed. He said, "Be patient, Venerable Kasapa. Women are foolish." And then So let's stop here for a moment. You see, this man was Mahakasapa because his psychic powers were very great. He said somewhere else, I said, his psychic power is so great that he cannot hide his psychic power. To hide his psychic power, it'd be like a big elephant trying to hide behind a coconut tree. He gave an example somewhere else. So maybe because of his great psychic power, when this nun uttered this statement, immediately he could hear. He got the heavenly ear. He even can hear ghost speaking. Why can't he hear the nun speaking? So you see the statement he made to the Venerable Ananda, very blunt. He said, "Friend Ananda, are you the needle peddler or am I the needle peddler?" So then after Ananda said, "Be patient," and he said, "Hold it, friend Ananda. Don't give the Sangha occasion to investigate you further." Stop here for a moment. Why is it? Don't give the Sangha occasion to investigate you further. This must have been the time after the Buddha passed away. Because when the Buddha passed away, the arahants, 500 arahants, held a meeting to repeat exactly what the Buddha taught so that they can agree on the words of the Buddha as far as the suttas and the Vinaya are concerned. And after that, they taught other monks to memorize according to this standard format. So on that first Sangha meeting, when the 500 arahants met, they took the opportunity to criticize Ananda. Why? Because they said, because of a few things, the Buddha did not want to form the order of nuns, And the Venerable Ananda pleaded with the Buddha three times to form the order of nuns. And the Buddha, usually after three times, he will accede. But in this case, even three times the Buddha refused. And Venerable Ananda was very stubborn. After that, he pleaded with the Buddha, quoting this Mahapajapati, this lady, the foster mother of the Buddha, who asked the Buddha to start the order of nuns. He said, Venerable Ananda said, "This is not an ordinary woman. When your mother died, she looked after you like her own son and all these things. You owe a lot to her." So because of all that, then the Buddha allowed the order of nuns to form. So that was one of the things they found fault with Venerable Ananda. So that's why I say they investigate him. So here this Venerable Kasapa is giving him a warning. Don't give the Sangha occasion to investigate you, Samo. What do you think, friend Ananda? Was it you that the Blessed One brought forward in the presence of the Bhikkhu Sangha, saying, "Monks, to whatever extent I wish, secluded from sensual pleasures, secluded from unwholesome states, I enter and dwell in the first jhana, which is accompanied by thought, directed and sustained, with delight and happiness born of seclusion. Ananda too, to whatever extent he wishes, secluded from sensual pleasures, secluded from unwholesome states, enters and dwells in the first jhana." So you see, it's a bit sarcastic here. The Buddha says, Kasapa too can enter and dwell in this. But he says, did the Buddha say Ananda too can dwell in the first jhana? So Venerable Ananda said, "No, Venerable Sir. I was the one friend that the Blessed One brought forward in the presence of the monk Sangha, saying, 'Monks, to whatever extent I wish, I enter and dwell in the first jhana. Kasapa too, to whatever extent he wishes, enters and dwells in the first jhana.'" And similarly, he quoted the rest of the other attainments which the Buddha said he can attain, and so can Venerable Kasapa. "I was the one friend that the Blessed One brought forward in the presence of the Bhikkhu Sangha, saying, 'Monks, by the destruction of the asavas in this very life, I enter and dwell in the taintless liberation of by mind, liberation by wisdom, realizing it for myself with direct knowledge. Kasapa too, by the destruction of the asavas in this very life, enters and dwells in the taintless liberation by mind, liberation by wisdom, realizing it for himself with direct knowledge. Friend, one might just as well think that a bull elephant 7 or 7.5 cubits high could be concealed by a palm leaf as think that my 6 direct knowledges could be concealed." Then the nun, Tulatisa, fell away from the holy life. That means she eventually disrobed. So actually it's very silly for her, because knowing that this Venerable Mahakasapa is an arahant, he should not be critical of arahant. So because she got bad karma, she cannot wear the robe long and disrobe. So you see the way Venerable Mahakasapa speaks is very blunt. you're not used to him and you don't know that he's an arahant, you get annoyed with him.
Maybe I can go one more sutta. 16.11.
On one occasion, the Venerable Mahakasapa was dwelling in Rajagaha in the bamboo grove, the squirrel sanctuary. On that occasion, the Venerable Ananda was wandering on tour in Dakshinagiri together with a large sangha of monks. On that occasion, 30 monks, pupils of the Venerable Ananda, most of them youngsters, had given up the training and had returned to the lower life. Stop here for a moment. That means 30 monk disciples of Venerable Ananda had disrobed. Venerable Ananda brought them, brought a large group of monks touring around. When the Venerable Ananda had wandered on tour in Dakshinagiri as long as he wanted, he came back to Rajagaha, to the bamboo grove, the squirrel sanctuary. He approached the Venerable Mahakasapa, paid homage to him and sat down to one side. And the Venerable Mahakasapa said to him, "Friend Ananda, for how many reasons did the Blessed One lay down the rule that monks should not take meals among families in groups of more than three?" Stop here for a moment. You see, there is a Vinaya rule that the Buddha laid down that monks should, when they go on alms round, generally should not, we should not have more than three monks on alms round. Because if you have too many monks on alms round, when lay people come to give food, they find so many monks, they find it difficult to give to so many monks. If they can't give to all the monks, they may feel a bit embarrassed. So the Buddha asked the monks to go on alms round generally, three groups of three or less, not more than three. And then Venerable Ananda said, "The Blessed One laid down this rule for three reasons, Venerable Kasapa. For restraining ill-behaved persons and for the comfort of well-behaved monks, with the intention, may those of evil wishes, by forming a faction, not create a schism in the Sangha, and out of sympathy towards families. It is for these three reasons, Venerable Kasapa, that the Blessed One laid down this rule." So here he says, there are three reasons. One is, I mentioned just now, our sympathy towards families, not making it difficult for them. Second one, for restraining ill-behaved persons. That means the monks, if there are too many of them, they tend to misbehave. And for the comfort of well-behaved monks, may those of evil wishes... You see, when you have a group of four monks, or more than four monks, it's considered a sangha. So when you have too many monks living together, if there's a disagreement and they break up, then you may have more than four monks on one side and more than four monks on the other side. If this happens, this is called a schism. And when a schism happens, whoever caused that schism creates the most heavy karma, one of the five heaviest karmas. He must go down to hell. So that's why... the Buddha says, for the comfort of well-behaved monks, so that they don't have a schism. Then Venerable Kasapa said, "Then why, friend Ananda, are you wandering about with these young monks who are unguarded in their sense faculties, immoderate in eating, and not devoted to wakefulness? One would think you were wandering about trampling on crops. One would think you were wandering about destroying families. Your retinue is breaking up, friend Ananda. Your young followers are slipping away, but still this youngster does not know his measure." And Venerable Ananda said, "Three hairs are growing on my head, Venerable Kasapa. Can't we escape being called a youngster by the Venerable Mahakasapa?" Stop here for a moment. So here, Venerable Kasapa is in a way like scolding Venerable Ananda, saying, "You are bringing all these young monks who... don't know how to guard their sense faculties. They are not moderate in eating. They are not devoted to wakefulness. That means they are not practicing very hard. And going around trampling other people's crops, people's veggie and all that. And you are destroying families, meaning you are making it very difficult for families to support the monks because you have such a big group of monks, maybe a few hundred. So he also said, your group is breaking up. Your young fellows are slipping away." And then he called Venerable Ananda, "This youngster does not know his measure." Mm-hmm. Actually, so Venerable Ananda said, "Grey hairs are growing on my head already. You still call me a youngster." Because at this time the Buddha had passed away. So the Venerable Ananda is of the same age as the Buddha. So the Buddha passed away at the age of 80. The Venerable Ananda was 80 or more than 80 years old already. And yet Venerable Kassapa called him Samanjaya, Sailo, Ginakya, small boy like that. Friend Ananda, it is just because you wander around with these young monks who are unguarded in their sense faculties, immoderate in eating and not devoted to wakefulness. One would think you were wandering around trampling on crops. One would think you were wandering about destroying families. Your retinue is breaking up, friend Ananda. Your young followers are slipping away. But still this youngster does not know his measure. So when Venerable Ananda objected, he purposely said the same thing again. And the nun, Tulananda, heard. Oh, this is another nun, Tulananda, heard. Master Mahakasapa has disparaged Master Ananda, the Vidyan sage, by calling him a youngster. And being displeased at this, he expressed her displeasure thus. How can Master Mahakasapa, who was formerly a member of another sect, think to disparage Master Ananda, the Vidyan sage, by calling him a youngster? Stop here for a moment. Here he says that Venerable Mahakasapa was formerly belonged to another religious sect. Actually, this is not true. The Venerable Mahakasapa overheard the nun Tulananda making this statement and said to the Venerable Ananda, "Surely, friend Ananda, the nun Tulananda made that statement rashly, without consideration. For since I shaved off my hair and beard, put on saffron robes, and went forth from the home life into homelessness, I do not recall ever having acknowledged any other teacher except the Blessed One, Arahant Sammasambuddha. In the past, friend, when I was still a householder, it occurred to me, household life is confinement, a path of dust. Going forth is like the open air. It is not easy for one living at home to lead the perfectly complete, perfectly purified holy life, which is like a polished conch. Let me then shave off my hair and beard, put on saffron robes, and go forth from the household life into homelessness. Sometime later, I had an outer robe made from patches of cloth. Then, acknowledging those who were arahants in the world as models, I shaved off my hair and beard, put on saffron robes, and went forth from the homeless, from the household life into homelessness. When I had thus gone forth, I was travelling along a road when I saw the Blessed One sitting by the Bahuputta shrine between Rajagaha and Nalanda. Having seen him, I thought, if I should ever see the teacher, it is the Blessed One himself that I would see. If I should ever see the Fortunate One, it is the Blessed One himself that I would see. If I should ever see the Perfectly Enlightened One, it is the Blessed One himself that I would see. Then I prostrated myself right there at the Blessed One's feet and said to him, Venerable Sir, the Blessed One is my teacher. I am his disciple. Venerable Sir, the Blessed One is my teacher. I am his disciple. When I had said this, the Blessed One said to me, Kassapa, if one who does not know and see should say to a disciple so single-minded as yourself, I know, I see, his head is split. But knowing Kassapa, I say I know. Seeing, I say I see. Let's stop here for a moment. So when the Buddha saw Venerable Mahakassapa, he saw that this Venerable Mahakassapa was a very advanced person. He said, here he says, so single-minded as yourself. So he said, if I'm to a disciple like you, if I'm not enlightened, and I say I am enlightened, my head also will split open. But I am enlightened, so I say I am enlightened. Therefore, Kassapa, you should train yourself thus. I will arouse a keen sense of shame and fear of wrongdoing towards elders, the newly ordained, and those of middle status. Thus should you train yourself. Therefore, Kassapa, you should train yourself thus. Whenever I listen to any Dhamma connected with the wholesome, I will listen to it with eager ears, attending to it as a matter of vital concern, applying my whole mind to it. Thus should you train yourself. Therefore, Kassapa, you should train yourself thus. I will never relinquish mindfulness directed to the body associated with joy. Thus should you train yourself. Then, having Then having given me this exhortation, the Blessed One rose from his seat and departed. For 7 days, friend, I ate the country's alms food as a debtor. But on the 8th day, final knowledge arose. Let's stop here for a moment. So you see, when he told the Buddha that he wanted to be the Buddha's disciple, the Buddha immediately accepted him and gave him 3 instructions. One is to respect the other monks, the elders, the newly ordained, and those of middle status, to have a sense of shame towards them. And then secondly, if you hear any Dhamma, you should listen to it attentively. Thirdly, keep your mindfulness directed to the body. Having given 3 instructions, the Buddha left. Then friend, the Blessed One, after receiving the instructions from the Buddha, he practiced very hard. For 7 days, he was not enlightened, but on the 8th day, he became enlightened. Then friend, the Blessed One descended from the robe and went to the foot of a tree. I folded in 4 my outer robe of patches and said to him, "Venerable Sir, let the Blessed One sit down here. This will lead to my welfare and happiness for a long time." The Blessed One sat down on the appointed seat and said to me, "Your outer robe of patches is soft, Kasapa. Venerable Sir, let the Blessed One accept my outer robe of patches out of compassion. Then will you wear my worn-out hempen rag robes?" "I will, Venerable Sir." Thus I offered the Blessed One my outer robe of patches and received from him his worn-out hempen rag robes. If friend, one speaking rightly could say of anyone, "He is the son of the Blessed One, born of his breast, born of his mouth, born of the Dhamma, created by the Dhamma, an heir to the Dhamma, a receiver of worn-out hempen rag robes," it is of me that one could rightly say this. Friend, to whatever extent I wish, secluded from sensual pleasures, secluded from unwholesome states, I enter and dwell in the first jhana, which is accompanied by thought, directed and sustained, etc. And similarly, he says he can enter into all the other jhana states and psychic powers, etc. Friend, by the destruction of the asvas in this very life, I enter and dwell in the taintless liberation by mind, liberation by wisdom, realizing it for myself with direct knowledge. Friend, one might just as well think that a bull elephant 7 or 7.5 cubits high could be concealed by a palm leaf, as think that my 6 direct knowledges could be concealed. But the nun Pulananda fell away from the holy life. That's the end of the sutta. So here, you see, the Venerable Mahakasapa, he's so blunt. He says again all of these things. If you don't understand him, you think he's a boaster, likes to boast of his attainments. But he has no more self. He's just stating a fact. So at the end of the sutta, it says that this nun, because she had sort of bad feelings to the Arahan, he also could not lead the holy life. She also disrobed. So that's all I have to say for tonight. We'll continue tomorrow. Anything to discuss? Yes. It means if a person has not become an arahant or an arya, then when a monk receives alms and other offerings from lay people, it is like credit card, otang. Don't deserve it, really. That's why it's very important for a person who wears the robes to practice. A lot of monks don't realize. They think just they wear the robe, they are worthy of all that offering. According to here, they are not worthy until you have become an arahant or at least an arya. Because once you have become an arya, you are on the way out of samsara. You definitely become enlightened. Right? Or because he comes from Videha. No, I don't think so. I don't think so. He's saying at that time when the Buddha mentioned this, at the time when the Buddha mentioned this, Venerable Ananda was not yet an Arahant. So Venerable, at that time when the Buddha mentioned this statement praising Venerable Mahakasapa, Venerable Ananda was not yet an Arahant. So it could be he had not attained all the jhanas and psychic power. It could have been that Venerable Ananda could have attained one or two jhanas. But the Buddha wants to praise a monk who has all the attainments, just like the Buddha. That's why the Buddha brought Venerable Mahakasapa in front of the monks and told them to praise him in front of all the monks. I mean, there are many monks who have partial attainments, but this Mahakasapa is one of those who has complete attainment. What the Buddha has, he has. Mahamoggallana is another one. Rama Mahakapina, another one. Rama Anuruddha, another one. There are many great arahants. You see, like the sutta we read about the time when the Buddha wanted to teach the Brahma. The Buddha flew to the Brahma world and emitted bright light. Immediately, many of his chief disciples knew, and they also came using their psychic power, and they all were floating and emitted light, just like the Buddha. Yes, yes, passed on. So actually it shows that even after a person becomes enlightened, our nature, our character, we still bring along with us. So even the Buddha himself, he has a certain character, although the books try to say, later books try to say that the Buddha is different, the Buddha is so perfect that he has no more any of his old habits. It's not true, because you find in the sutta, there's one sutta where the Buddha really castigated the Brahmins, saying, compare them to dogs, saying that dogs are even better than Brahmins. That's one. Another thing is sometimes the Buddha sometimes likes to joke in a certain way. Sometimes there's one sutta where the Buddha came to Kapilavatthu, I think, and had to look. He came, I think, in the evening. And then he asked his cousin, Mahanama, to look for a place for him to stay. So Mahanama went around, could not find any place except the hermitage of an external sect ascetic. So probably he knows that the Buddha knows this external sect ascetic. Years ago, they could have practiced together under the same teacher. So the Venerable Mahanama brought the Buddha to stay with this ascetic. Then at night, Mahanama came to see the Buddha, and the Buddha wanted to discuss Dhamma with Mahanama. So asked him a question. Before Mahanama could reply, this ascetic told Mahanama to answer in such a way. So I think the Buddha was annoyed. The Buddha purposely told Mahanama answer a different way. Then this ascetic thought, he must be wrong. Then he asked Mahanama to answer in the second way. And then surprisingly, the Buddha asked Mahanama to answer back the first way. Did this three times, and this ascetic was so embarrassed, each time he was wrong. So he malu, no face, he left and never came back again. So in a way, the Buddha still has his old character. These suttas on the Kasapa Sanyutta, although they don't have much Dhamma, they are very interesting because he shows you the character of the arahants. Each arahant is different in character. So if you don't understand that they are arahants, somebody like Kasapa, if you meet him, you think this fellow is behaving like an uneducated fellow. No, 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 no. You cannot see that because of him the nun disrobed. No, no, no. And the nun, because of having bad thoughts against an arahant, so she cannot continue the holy life. Thoughts will disturb her. What page? What about? Yeah. Yes. 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 Yeah. Yes, yes. It's, I think we read one of the suttas. It says, if you do demeritorious deeds, then you go to a demeritorious rebirth. If you do meritorious deeds, then you go to a meritorious rebirth. But if you don't do any deeds and you let go, then you don't go for rebirth. But this doing deeds is only one of the conditions. The other one is like ignorance. Another one is like letting go of craving, clinging, and all that. So actually, you see here, these three, what one intends, what one plans, and whatever one has a tendency towards, this is a basis for the maintenance of consciousness. But remember, in the under dependent origination, what conditions vijnana, consciousness, is sankara, volition. So these three things are the different aspects of volition. Cheteti, the first one, intending, is also a kind of volition. What you plan, pakapeti, is also another type of volition. And the tendency towards something, that means anusaya, tendency, is a kind of like a craving. That is also a kind of volition. So basically, it is volition. You use your mind in any way. So eventually, you have to stop using your mind if you want to become liberated. As I said before, it's very difficult to stop using your mind because as long as you have a self, you want to protect the self. So if you want to protect the self, you keep using your mind. That's only the person who is so advanced spiritually that he has no more desire to live, no more desire for anything, then he is willing to stop using his mind. Yeah. Mm. Determination, and also because his mind is not like ordinary people. His mind is so strong, just like the Buddha. The Buddha says, when he's about just before he passed away, he's 80 years old. The Buddha says his body is like a worn out horse carriage. That needs to, if you want it to keep going, you have to repair it here, repair it there. But the Buddha says, I don't think that my mind is like that. Buddha said his mind has never deteriorated. The Buddha said if two monks were to ask him question for 100 years and he, even to the extent that he cannot get up, he must lie on the bed, he can still answer them for 100 years some more. So in other words, his mind has never deteriorated. It's only the body that deteriorates. But most of us, because our mind is not so strong, so our body can influence our mind a lot.
Okay, transfer merit.